نحن نقص عليك أحسن القصص بما أوحينا إليك هذا القرآن وإن كنت من قبله لمن الغافلين.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one and the unique. It is He that we praise and it is His blessings that we seek. He is the Lord of the oppressed and the one who answers the du'as of the weak. Alhamdulillah, we are continuing in our series of the prophets and the messengers, and we're still in our introductory series of lectures. And so these are setting the stage. These are making us understand the goal and the role and the vision and the wisdom of sending the prophets and the messengers. So today, inshallah ta'ala, we will continue by listing some of the Quranic wisdom, some of the explicit Quranic wisdoms of sending the prophets. In other words, what is the role of the prophets and messengers? What does the Quran tell us about why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent prophets and messengers? And if you read the verses of the Quran, you can gather three primary motifs, and under each of them there are sub-branches. If you read the Quran and you try to gather all of the verses pertaining to the Quranic wisdom of the role and the responsibilities and the tasks and the wisdom of sending prophets and messengers, and what is Allah requiring of them, you can gain three primary concepts. And the first of these is the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the knowledge of what we need to know. And this can be divided into multiple categories. So let's say one is to teach us what we need to know and to give us knowledge that would not otherwise be accessible to us. This is without a doubt the primary wisdom and role of the prophets. Without the prophets, we would not have knowledge that is required for us to understand ourselves, to situate ourselves, to contextualize ourselves, to know who we are. And this knowledge is multifaceted. So number one, they came with knowledge we cannot obtain. What type of knowledge? 1A, knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and telling us who is our creator and affirming to us the reality of His existence and the beauty of His names and His attributes. So this is without a doubt the most important knowledge that the prophets came with, and that is the knowledge of Allah Himself. So in Surah Ibrahim, verse 10, Allah says, قَالَتْ لَهُمْ رُسُلُهُمْ أَفِلْ Their prophets said to them, is there any doubt about Allah who is the Fatiru Samawati wal Ard? So they're arguing with their people and their qawm, and they're explaining to them, how can you doubt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And they're reminding them, who is Allah? He is the Fatir of the Samawat and the Ard. We also have in the beautiful story of Ibrahim alayhi salam in Surah Al-An'am, وَحَاجَّهُ قَوْمُهُ, and his people argued with him. قَالَ أَتُحَاجُّونِي فِي اللَّهِ وَقَدْ هَدَانِ. He said, are you going to argue with me about Allah? You're going to teach me something about Allah? You're going to negate the existence of Allah, even though it is Allah who has guided me to all of this. He taught me, He informed me, and now I'm informing you. Are you going to argue with me about Allah, and Allah told me this knowledge? What knowledge do you have versus the knowledge that is coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And that is why Ibrahim alayhi salam argued with his people about the reality of the Creator. They had different gods and they had different objects of worship. And Ibrahim alayhi salam says, Inni wajjahtu wajhiya lilladhi fatara as-samawati wal-ardha hanifa. I am going to turn my face to the one who originated the heavens and the earth. Wama ana min al-mushrikeen. I am not going to associate partners with him. We also see this reality of affirming the existence and the perfection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the confrontation of Musa alayhi salam with Fir'aun. And this is a beautiful passage in Surah Ash-Shu'ara 23 onwards. And by the way, today we have a lot of verses. So again, I hope many of you are taking notes and benefiting. And the goal, dear brothers and sisters, isn't just to listen to me. The goal is to understand and take notes and go back to the Quran yourselves. Find other examples. I want to reintroduce you to our classical text, to the holy book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want you to verify every verse that I say. Go back and read it in context and read it in the Arabic so that your iman can increase and you have a better understanding and appreciation of this beautiful religion and of the book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to us. So Surah Ash-Shu'ara, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a beautiful conversation. That's actually one of my favorite passages in the Quran, of back and forth between Fir'aun and between Musa. And there's so much wisdom, but we don't have time to go into that tangent. Inshallah, one day when we talk about Musa and Fir'aun, inshallah ta'ala, I will go into all of the benefits we can derive, or at least some of the benefits we can derive from this series of verses and this conversation. But today, for our purposes, Musa alayhi salam, he goes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he says that I have been sent by the Rabbul Alameen. Qala Fir'aun, wama Rabbul Alameen? Fir'aun said, what is this wama, not waman, wama, what is this concept of Rabbul Alameen? You see, Musa has a knowledge that the people of Egypt do not have. And Musa is saying, the Rabbul Alameen sent me. And of course, Fir'aun would tell them, I am the Rabbul Alameen. He would say, I am your Rabb. Rabb, as Allah says in the Quran, أنا ربكم الأعلى. I am your exalted God, أعوذ بالله. And Musa comes and says, no, you are not God. You are not God. Allah, the Rabbul Alameen, has sent me. And so, Fir'aun says, وَمَا رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ? And Musa responds, رَبُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ مَا بَيْنَهُمَا إِن كُنْتُمْ مُوقِنِينَ. My Rabb is the Rabb of the heavens and the earth. You, O Fir'aun, are claiming to be the Rabb, but you are only in Egypt. How can you be the Rabb and your domain is limited? As for my Rabb, he is unconditionally the Rabb. Unlimited, he is the Rabb. He is the Rabb of the heavens and the earth. You can't be a partial God. You can't be a God only in Egypt, and outside of Egypt, people don't like you. What type of God is this? As for my Rabb, رَبُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ مَا بَيْنَهُمَا إِن كُنْتُمْ مُوقِنِينَ. So Fir'aun understood the implication, and what he did was he began mocking, this is the PR campaign, he began mocking Musa in front of his people. And Fir'aun said, قَالَ لِمَنْ حَوْلَهُ. Fir'aun said to the people around him, أَلَا تَسْتَمِعُونَ. Don't you listen to this guy? See what he is saying? And Musa then went on, قَالَ رَبُّكُمْ وَرَبُّ أَبَائِكُمُ الْأَوَّلِينَ. He is your Lord and the Lord of your forefathers before you. In other words, Musa alayhi salam is saying very, very powerfully, how can you be a God when you were born and you're going to die? Before you, your father said he was God. After you, your son is going to say he is God. And who was the God of them? And who is going to be the God of your children? As for the real Rabb, قَالَ رَبُّكُمْ وَرَبُّ أَبَائِكُمُ الْأَوَّلِينَ. My Rabb is unlimited. My Rabb goes from the beginning of time and even before. He is the Awwal and he is the Akhir. And so, in the first verse, the space factor is eliminated. In the second verse, the time factor is eliminated. Allah Azza wa Jal is unconditionally the Rabb. Now, by the way, what is happening here? The knowledge of Musa versus the knowledge of the people of Egypt, right? Fir'aun is saying that he is the Rabb and he has different concept of God. Musa comes and explains who is a God. My God, your God, the God of this creation is unlimited. This is the wisdom of sending the prophets of Allah. And then Fir'aun mocked him and said, قَالَ إِنَّ رَسُولَكُمُ الَّذِي أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ لَمَجْنُونَ. Verily, the prophet that has been sent to you must be a mad man, insane, crazy. And this is the way of the enemies of the truth. When they cannot resort to logic and reason, they resort to slander. This is called ad hominem attack. You attack the character, you attack the person, you don't attack the message. That is not the real debate. The real debate, you look at the facts, you look at the realities. If you have to resort to attacking the persona rather than the message, then you are failing in your actual attack. And this is what Fir'aun does, and this is what every opponent of the truth does. They cannot combat the truth with knowledge, so they resort to attacking the person who's bringing that knowledge. And he says, this man must be crazy. And then Musa responds, قَالَ رَبُّ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. My Rabb is the Rabb of the East and the West. If you only had any sense, everything around is the Rabb. Once again, the names and attributes of Allah. And then what does Fir'aun do? This is the way of the tyrants. This is the way of the rejectors of the truth. When they can't argue, when they can't negotiate, when mocking fails, when ad hominem doesn't do the job, then they resort to violence and threats. This is the way of the thugs and the tyrants. You cannot challenge the truth. So what do? You end up mocking, rejecting the person, making fun of the messenger, and then when all of this fails, what does Fir'aun say? قَالَ لَئِنِ اتَّخَذْتَ إِلَٰهًا غَيْرِي لَأَجْعَلَنَّكَ مِنَ الْمَسْجُونِينَ He said, if you dare take another god besides me, then I'm going to throw you in jail. I'm going to punish and torture you. And this shows us again, for our purposes, the wisdom of sending the prophets, because they have a knowledge of Allah. And the same goes for the story of Yusuf alayhi salam as well. When he was in the prison, we see the same thing, that the prisoners, they believed in polytheism, they believed in multiple gods. And Yusuf says that, يَا صَاحِبَيَ السِّجْنِ O my companions in jail, أَأَرْبَابٌ مُتَفَرِّقُونَ خَيْرٌ أَمِ اللَّهُ الْوَاحِدُ الْقَهَارُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِهِ إِلَّا أَسْمَاءً سَمَّيْتُمُوهَا أَنْتُمْ وَأَبَاؤُكُمْ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ بِهَا مِن سُلْطَانٍ So Yusuf alayhi salam tells the people of the jail, what makes more sense? Lots of gods fighting each other, each one is separate, or one Lord? One Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is al-wahid and al-qahhar. In reality, these other gods that you worship don't actually exist. They are figments of the imagination that you are claiming. They are not actually real. And this is, once again, Yusuf alayhi salam teaching knowledge of Allah to his people. So this is the first concept of knowledge, and that is the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second knowledge that they come with, and the second teaching that they come with, is the knowledge of the worship of Allah, right? And this is another key point, which is a corollary to the knowledge of the existence of Allah and the knowledge of the names and attributes of Allah. The prophets also come with the knowledge of the worship and the command to worship and the motivation to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the methodology, I should say, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the command to worship Allah is also fundamental to all of the prophets. Every single prophet came with this command and with this knowledge. As Allah says in the Quran, Surah An-Nahl, verse 36. That Allah says, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا We have sent a messenger to every single ummah. أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ What did he come with? Worship Allah. This is now the knowledge of the worship of Allah. This is now implementing the abstract of the existence into the tangible of the actions of worship. أَنِعْبُدُ اللَّهِ Worship Allah. وَجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ And avoid the false gods. In Surah Al-Anbiya, verse 25, Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِن قَبْلِكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ That we have not sent before you except any messenger that we have inspired them, La ilaha illa Allah. That we have inspired them with the kalima of La ilaha illa Allah. Nothing should be worshipped other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, the prophets come not just with the knowledge of who is Allah, but with the command to then worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this tells us another key point, which is that the reality of faith, the reality of iman, is not just the mere affirmation of the existence of Allah. The reality of iman necessitates that one implements that knowledge into action as well, and one then worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the second category of knowledge and commandments is the knowledge and the commandments of worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third category of commandments as well, the third category of knowledge, excuse me, as well, is the knowledge of the halal and the haram, and the knowledge of how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have said, number one is the knowledge of Allah. Number two is the command to worship Allah. Number three, what the prophets are coming with, this is all still under category one, by the way, right? So don't get confused. So category one is they're coming with broad knowledge that we will not know without them. So now we're talking about what type of knowledge. We're trying to classify what knowledge is beyond the scope of mankind's, you know, intellect. What knowledge do we need that direct wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The third category is the knowledge of the rituals and the knowledge of the halal and the haram. And this is something again mentioned in the Quran. يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ that the Quran mentions that يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَاهُمْ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. He commands them what is good and he forbids them what is evil. وَيُحِلُّ لَهُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَائِثِ. He makes halal that which is pure and he makes haram that which is impure. And Allah says in the Quran, لِكُلٍّ جَعَلْنَا مِنْكُمْ شِرْعَةً وَمِنْهَاجًا. To every prophet amongst you, we have given them a sharia and we have given them a way. So the sharia comes down as well. We would not know the details of law. How is our brain going to tell us that we should pray in this manner, that we should fast the month of Ramadan? How is our intellect going to guide us to the details and the minutiae of the laws of our faith? How is that going to happen? We need wahi from Allah. We need that knowledge from the Prophet. So we have knowledge of Allah, the command to worship Allah, and then how to implement that command to worship Allah. This is the third category of knowledge. The fourth category of knowledge that we would not be able to acquire on our own is the knowledge of the afterlife, the knowledge of heaven and hell, the knowledge of punishments and rewards. And this is one of the fundamental pillars of our faith tradition. So fundamental that whoever denies this is not a Muslim. We all know that our religion is based upon three fundamental points of theology. Number one, iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, iman in the prophets. And number three, iman in al-yawm al-akhir and heaven and hell. These three fundamentals are what make us Muslim. Anybody who doubts any one of them is simply not a Muslim. They're not a believer in our faith tradition. And so the prophets come affirming belief in Allah and then also talking about belief in the hereafter. Our minds would never be able to come to the conclusion of heaven and hell. They're not going to definitively come to that conclusion. Our minds will never grasp what's going to happen after death. We would never understand that there's a day of judgment intellectually. It's not something that you can affirm from a logical perspective. It is supra-rational, beyond rationality. Not irrational, supra-rational. And supra means beyond rationality. And the concept of heaven and hell and reward and punishment goes back, of course, to the day of judgment. And that is why the day of judgment is a fundamental knowledge that all of the prophets of Allah came with. No prophet was sent except that he taught his people of heaven and hell and of reward and punishment and of Jannah and Nar and of Qiyamah. And this is why one of the most common descriptions of the prophets, more than a dozen verses, I don't have time to list all of them, but please do your research and read the Quran and extract them for your own personal, notebooks and whatnot for these topics, that more than a dozen verses describe the prophets as being Mubashir and Munzir, or Bashir and Nadir. And Mubashir and Munzir mean giving glad tidings and warning. And Bashir and Nadir, the same thing. They come to give cheerful news and they come to also terrify, to warn, to reprimand. What is the cheerful? What is the Mubashir? What is the Bashir? Allah says in the Quran, that Surah Hud, verse 25, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ, that we sent Nuh to his people and he said, إِنِّي لَكُمْ نَذِيرٌ مُبِينٌ. I am a clear and open warner. I am warning you, the first Rasul. And he uses the word Nadir. In Surah Saba, verse 34, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِي قَرْيَةٍ مِن نَذِيرٍ, that we never sent a warner to a society, إِلَّا قَالَ مُتْرَفُوهَا, except that the rich and the powerful said, we are going to reject what you have been sent with. In Surah Fatir, verse 24, إِنَّا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ بِالْحَقِّ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا وَإِن مِّنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَى فِيهَا, what? Nadir. We are sending you as a Bashir and a Nadir, and not a single community has existed, Allah is saying, except that they have been sent a Nadir. So Bashir and Nadir, and every ummah has a Bashir and a Nadir. In Surah Najm, verse 56, هَذَا نَذِيرٌ مِّنَ النُّذُرِ الْأُولَى. The Prophet ﷺ is described in the Quran. He is a Nadir, just like all of the earlier Nadirs came. Nothing different. هَذَا نَذِيرٌ مِّنَ النُّذُرِ الْأُولَى. This messenger is a warner like the previous warners that came. And Allah says in Surah Nisa, verse 165, رُسُلَ مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ. رُسُل were مُبَشِّر and مُنذِر, giving glad tidings, delivering good news, and also warning and reprimanding the people. Why? لِكَيْ لَا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرُّسُلِ, so that there is no excuse for mankind in front of Allah after the coming of the messengers. And Allah Azza wa Jalla clearly mentions that وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ, we have only sent messengers إِلَّا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ, as مُبَشِّر Mubashir and Munzir. Exclusivity, what is the role of the prophets? Mubashir and Munzir. Why? What is the purpose? فَمَنْ آمَنَ وَأَصْلَحَ فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ Whoever does good and believes, they have no cause to grieve, nor will they worry. And we can go on and on. So the point here, what does Bashir and Nadir entail? It means, if you worship Allah, and you are pious, and you are righteous, then alhamdulillah, be happy. Be happy, and you will be rewarded, and you will go to Jannah, and everything will be smooth sailing for you. And if you reject Allah, and you disobey, and you commit sins, and you are arrogant, then I warn you of an impending doom. I warn you of a punishment. So Bashir and Nadir implies very clearly heaven and hell, reward and punishment, Qiyamah. All of this is included in Bashir and Nadir. And notice here that pretty much every time, not every single verse, but pretty much the norm is that these two go together, Bashir and Nadir. And this is to indicate that the psychology of da'wah, the psychology of preaching, means you mention both of them. You don't concentrate only on one. You always mention, if you're righteous, you will go to Jannah. If you are not, then there will be the opposite of that. So this is another category, and that is to teach the knowledge of heaven and hell, the knowledge of the hereafter, the knowledge of the rewards and the punishment. And yet another category of knowledge is to overall convey the message of Allah. We call it in Arabic, تَبْلِيغُ الرِّسَالَةِ, right? To convey the message. Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الرَّسُولُ, O Prophet, بَلِّغْ مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ. Go ahead and convey, it's a command. You must convey everything that has been revealed to you from your Lord. فَإِنْ لَمْ تَفْعَلْ فَمَا بَلَّغْتَ رِسَالَتَهُ. If you don't do this, then you have not done your job of conveying the message. وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you from the people. Indeed, Allah does not guide the people who reject. So, يَا أَيُّهَا الرَّسُولُ بَلِّغْ. O Prophet, your job is tabligh. Your job is to convey the message. In Surah Ali Imran, verse 20, Allah says in the Quran, فَإِنْ حَاجُّكَ. If they're arguing with you, Ya Rasulullah, فَقُلْ أَسْلَمْتُ وَجْهِيَ لِلَّهِ وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِ. Then say to them, as for me, I'm going to submit to Allah. And all the people who follow me are going to submit to Allah. And ask them, have you also submitted? If they submit, they will be rightly guided. But if they turn away, وَإِن تَوَلَّوْا فَإِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ الْبَلَاغِ, then your job is only to convey. And in multiple verses in the Quran, إِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ الْبَلَاغُ وَعَلَيْنَا الْحِسَابِ. Your job is balagh, our job is hisab. This is the role of the prophets. The prophets are sent to convey the message, to make sure that whatever Allah tells them, they say unto mankind. Okay? So this is the first large motif. And that is basically the knowledge that we would not be able to obtain without the wahi from Allah. And that is no doubt, this is the fundamental wisdom and role of the messengers. And they come with multiple knowledge. Knowledge of Allah, and knowledge of the command to worship Allah, and knowledge of how to worship Allah, and knowledge of the repercussions of worshiping Allah or of not worshiping Allah, and knowledge of the entire risalah or the entire wahi that Allah Azza wa Jal has given them. Okay, what is another role and purpose of sending the prophets? Point number two, that was 1A, B, C, D, all of that. Now we go to point number two. Point number two is to elucidate and clarify and explain and implement all of that knowledge in action. So it's not just conveying and speech. It's not just theory. It's not just abstract. It is the demonstration of the realities of this knowledge, the implementation of that theory into practice. And so this is the second point. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never sent just a book onto a mountain and left it there. Because if that were the way to obtain knowledge, there's no need for a prophet. Because you can send a book, a manual, and khalas, people will find it and the miracle will be there and they can take the book. No, never. Never did Allah send a book down without a prophet. Rather, the prophets came first and they brought the books with them. And what is the purpose of a human coming? So that this human being can clarify and explain, can elucidate and elaborate. And that is because, and we got to get now to 2a, let's say, that knowledge is not just delivery. It must be practiced and you have to be trained by an expert. Again, let me give you the examples. For example, you know, when you go into medicine, for example, you have the theory and then you have the rotations. You go and you actually practice. When you do an engineering job, as soon as you're hired, first few months, you're simply training. You have to be trained. That training, right? Imagine now, what if it's much more important than medicine and engineering? Who's going to train you? That's why the prophets came and they lived amongst their people. They interacted with their followers. Every prophet lived for years, for decades, for centuries, many of them. And they interacted with their followers and they taught their core group of followers so that their followers can then go on and teach the next generation. And so 2A, and that is the implementation of that knowledge and the explanation and elucidation of the revelation of Allah. Allah says in the Quran, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ. This is Surah An-Nahl, verse 44. وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ. We have revealed to you this Quran. And your job, Ya Rasulullah, لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. Your job, to clarify to mankind what has been revealed to them, and so that they can reflect and understand. Notice, لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ. The wahi is there, but there is a human interpreter that Allah has chosen, and his interpretation is divinely inspired. He is not divine, but what he says takes on the status of divine inspiration. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said when he pointed to his tongue, everything that they said, it is the truth when he says it about this religion. Whatever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says about the Quran, about Allah, about heaven and hell, about our sharia, everything is a wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he is making the tibyan, he is making the bayan, he is explaining and elucidating. Also, under this category as well, not just the elucidation of the revelation, but the implementation of the revelation. And this is 2b. That is, to live as a role model, to be a actual lived manifestation of a worshipper, to demonstrate in your lifestyle and in your actions what it means to worship Allah and to be a believer. And that's why Allah says in the Quran multiple times to take the prophets as role models. To take the prophets as role models. Surah Al-An'am, verse 90. Allah mentions many prophets and then he says that these are the rightly guided people. فَبِهُدَاهُمْ مُقْتَدِهِ. And so you should be guided by their customs and their manners. Their huda, you follow their guidance as well. And Surah Al-Ahzab, verse 21, Allah says in the Quran, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Verily, you have in the Messenger of Allah a perfect conduct and role model to follow. Uswatun hasana. Uswa means something that you imitate, something that you follow. Hasana, the best you can have, the perfect role model. And this is another reason for sending a prophet, so that he can be a role model. As Allah says, innaka la'ala khuluqin azim. You are, Ya Rasulullah, upon a magnificent manner. And as Aisha said, kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an. His actions and his interactions and his mannerisms were that of the Quran. He was a walking Quran. He demonstrated what it means to be a believer and an implementer of Allah's worship and Allah's sharia. And that is because mankind needs an example that is human, a realistic example, an example that they can look up to and aspire, an example that is one of them and yet also is chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this also goes, and we're going to come back to this point later on inshallah, this also goes back to the wisdom of why Allah sent human prophets. Allah never sent angels to mankind as prophets, never. The angels communicate with one human, that is the Prophet. Then the Prophet communicates with us. So the angel comes from Allah Azza wa Jal to that one human. But it is the human who then communicates to us. And this was a cause of surprise for the Quraysh. The Quraysh said, Surah Al-An'am, verse 9, وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ. The Quraysh had not understood the concept of prophets. The Quraysh were not an Abrahamic religion-based civilization. They were children of Abraham, but they were not Abrahamic in their faith. And they weren't like the Jews and Christians who understood prophecy. They never understood or heard of the concept of prophets. And that's why they said, what is a prophet? What is a Nabi? And when the Prophet ﷺ came, their minds said, why would Allah send a human like us? Why would he send a person? وَقَالُوا مَا لِهَذَا الرَّسُولِ يَأْكُلُ الطَّعَامَ وَيَمْشِي فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ What type of prophet is this? He is eating our food and he's walking in the streets. لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ Why doesn't an angel come down? Why doesn't an angel come down? And in Surah Al-An'am, وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ And they say, why isn't an angel sent down by Allah? So in their minds, they couldn't understand the wisdom of a human prophet. And Allah Azza wa Jal responds, وَلَوْ أَنزَلْنَا مَلَكًا لَقُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ ثُمَّ لَا يُنظَرُونَ If we were to send an angel, then that settles the affair. It settles the affair completely. Now there's a number of interpretations. What exactly does that mean? That most ulama say that Allah sends angels when it is time to punish a people. And when the punishment comes, then they will see the angels. So Allah is saying, you want the angels, that means you want to be destroyed. And there are other interpretations as well. And then Allah says, وَلَوْ جَعَلْنَاهُ And then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَلَوْ أَنزَلْنَا مَلَكًا And if we were to send an angel down, لَجَعَلْنَاهُ رَجُلًا We would have made him shaped like a human being. وَلَلَبِسْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ مَا يَلْبِسُونَ And we would cause this human to be dressed, this angel to be dressed the way that they themselves are being dressed in. And some have interpreted this to mean that this would have caused confusion. Both interpretations are allowed in this verse. The point that Allah is saying is that you're asking for an angel. If an angel came, you would not be able to see the angel. Because we don't see angels. Do you see angels right now? Do I see angels? The angels are around us. We believe there are two angels right here. We believe the angels are in the masjid. We believe the angels come and read the Quran. Who has seen them? Only if Allah wills, rarely does a righteous see an angel. But generally speaking, we don't see angels. So Allah is saying, if I were to send an angel, I'd have to make him shape like a human. And he'd be dressed like you, talking like you, speaking like you, and you wouldn't even understand that he's an angel. And so you're going to become even more confused. I don't send angels as prophets. And that is why in the Quran, the humanity of the prophets itself becomes a point of contention. Surah At-Taghabun, ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُ كَانَ تَأْتِيمُ رُسُلٌ بِالْبَيَنَاتِ فَقَالُوا أَبَشَرٌ يَهْدُونَنَا That is because the prophets would come to them with guidance from Allah. And they would say, وَقَالُوا أَبَشَرٌ يَهْدُونَنَا How can humans guide us? How can other humans guide us, right? And so, for those who don't understand the concept of prophecy, they rejected, one of the reasons why they rejected the prophets is because they were human beings. And yet, on the other hand, you need a human. This is what Allah is saying to this psychology. You need a human to emulate, to love and respect, to take as a role model. Because if another entity came, if an angel came, the human could say, I can't imitate you, you're an angel. You're too good. What am I supposed to do with you? That's why Allah says in the Quran, وَإِلَىٰ عَادٍ أَخَاهُمْ هُدَىٰ وَإِلَىٰ ثَمُودَ أَخَاهُمْ صَالِحًا That, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ That every prophet comes with the language of his people, being from his people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, that Fir'aun himself says to Musa, قَالَ أَلَمْ نُرَبِّكَ فِينَا وَلِيدًا وَلَبِثَّ فِينَا مِنْ عُمُورِكَ سِنِينَ The familiarity at once becomes a cause of rejection and a cause of acceptance, right? Because you recognize, because you know, it's easier to reject. But because you know, how can you reject when you know the character of this person? So Fir'aun says to Musa, didn't we raise you up as a child? Didn't we take care of you, and you spent years amongst us, his humanity is being called into question. How can you be a prophet? You were the child. We know you. We took care of you. We pulled you out of the river Nile. We saved you. Now you come back to us as a prophet. So the humanity of Musa and his innocence as a child is thrown back at him. And then Musa says, so yes, you did that. And that's something that I admit that you took care of me. But Allah Azza wa Jalla chose me to be the prophet. The same goes for our prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he used uses this as an evidence for his prophethood, that you knew me. فَقَدْ لَبِثْتُ فِيكُمْ عُمُرًا مِّن قَبْلِهِ. I lived a lifetime amongst you. How can you not understand that what is happening now is not the me of old? Something new is happening. I'm coming with a revelation you never heard before. I'm preaching a message that you have no precedence in my whole life. How can you doubt this? فَقَدْ لَبِثْتُ فِيكُمْ عُمُرًا مِّن قَبْلِهِ. And in another similar verse in the Quran, Allah says, وَمَا كُنْتَ تَدُّ مِن قَبْلِهِ مِن كِتَابٍ وَلَا تَخُطُّهُ بِيَمِينِكَ. You didn't used to author books. You didn't have a pen and you're writing with the right hand. You weren't a poet that people could now doubt. You have a character that is established as a human being in your people. Now, overnight, all of this change happens that indicates that something has happened, and that is a revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, the humanity of the prophets, even though it is a source of contention and rejection, still, at the same time, Allah says you need a human. And that human you can recognize and you can emulate and you can admire. And that human you can take as a role model. And that is one of the wisdoms of sending the prophets. And of sending, generally speaking, almost all the prophets, one or two exceptions. For example, Lut and others were not from the people. There was nobody in the town of Sodom that Allah chose. Allah chose Lut and sent him to Sodom. There was not a single person of Sodom. أَلَيْسَ مِنْكُمْ رَجُلٌ رَشِيدٌ. Not a single person that had khair and good. The entire city was depraved and corrupt. But generally speaking, most of the prophets were sent from their own peoples. And there is much wisdom in this. As Allah says in the Quran, we have sent prophets who speak the language of their own people. And we send prophets from their own tribes. وَإِلَىٰ عَادٍ أَخَاهُمْ. To Ad their brother, to Thamud their brother, one of their own people, so they can recognize. And in that humanity is the potential for emulation, the potential for genuine admiration and respect, which is what happened, of course, to the believers of all of the prophets. So this is to be, and that is to become a role model in your lifestyle, in your actual customs and manners. To see, and that is to not just become role model in your personal example, to not just become role models in your individual lifestyles, but rather to implement the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at a national, or at a, if you like, societal level. And this basically is the political establishment of the laws of the Sharia and of the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, by the way, not all the prophets were given this. In fact, it is true to state that as far as we know, the majority of prophets did not get this level. The majority of prophets were not able to implement at a societal level. They could only preach and teach and implement at a personal level. They could not implement at a societal level. They were not given political authority in the land. Jesus Christ, for example, was not given political authority. And the bulk of the prophets that came were not given that type of political authority, but some of them were. So, for example, the Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam and the Prophet Dawood as well, they were given that type of honor. So Allah says in the Quran, يَا دَاوُودُ إِنَّا جَعَلْنَاكَ خَلِيفَةً فِي الْأَرْضِ فَحْكُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ بِالْقِسْطِ. O Dawood, we have made you a khalifa on this earth. And khalifa here means somebody that is going to judge and rule. And that's why Allah says, يَا دَاوُودُ إِنَّا جَعَلْنَاكَ خَلِيفَةً فِي الْأَرْضِ فَحْكُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. Judge between people. So Dawood is the khalifa. And he must judge between the people based upon the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says in the Quran to our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Surah Al-Ma'idah, وَأَنِحْكُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ. And judge between them according to what Allah has revealed. And judge between them according to what Allah has revealed. The messenger's job is to be the judge, the one who executes the judgments of Allah, who implements the judgments of Allah. And this is what happened in the Medinan phase, to strive to bring about a society based upon the ethos and the laws of the Sharia. Now, as I said, this is something that many of the prophets were not given, but those that were given, that was another manifestation, to see a society, an entire society that was structured upon the laws of Islam and the political establishment punishment of the Sharia and the manifestation of an entire community of believers that are embodying the values of our faith. That too is the goal of some of the prophets. Not all of them were given that opportunity, as we said. Even the Prophet Musa alayhi salam, for example, he was not able to do that in Egypt. And then of course, when he was wandering, there was no community per se. It was only wandering tribes. He wasn't able to establish a law in the lands of Israel, because obviously he did not get to that land. So the point being, this is the goal of some of the prophets, and not all of them were granted this. And that is Allah's choice, that he chooses whoever he wants to give this to. So this is point number two, and that is the practical manifestation of point number one. Point number one is theoretical knowledge in different types. Point number two, practical manifestation in different types. Point number three, a very, very deep point of why Allah sends the prophets and messengers. What is the wisdom of sending prophets and messengers? And that is the establishment of the evidence. Iqamatu al-hujjah. Iqamatu al-hujjah. What does this mean? It is a Quranic term, by the way. It is a Quranic term. We hear it all the time. Iqamatu al-hujjah. And the notion of iqamatu al-hujjah is a very, very deep and a very theological one. And that is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of a divine wisdom, and because He wanted to be just and fair, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed that even if I have given mankind many divine gifts, and I've given them the gift of the intellect and the gift of the pure fitrah, still I will not punish them and I will not hold them accountable until I have given them a clear and explicit message from one of my prophets. And that prophet has come to them and explained to them the message. And then, after hearing the message, they choose to reject the message. This is what is called iqamatu al-hujjah. And this is something that Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in many, many verses. In Surah Taha, verse 134, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if we had sent an adab before this, لقالوا, they would have said that لَوْلَا يَأْتِينَ بِآيَةٍ مِنْ رَبِّهِ, that why didn't they bring to us a sign from the prophets of old? And Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran as well, that وَقَالُوا رَبَّنَا لَوْلَا أَرْسَلْتَ إِلَيْنَا رَسُولًا. They would say, oh our Lord, why didn't you send a messenger? لَوْلَا أَرْسَلْتَ إِلَيْنَا رَسُولًا. Why didn't you send a messenger? If you had sent a messenger, فَنَتَّبِعَ آيَاتِكَ, we would have followed your revelations before this punishment and this humiliation. And in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 143, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ وَيَكُونَ رَسُولَ عَلَيْكُمْ شَهِيدًا. We have made you an upright community so that you may be a witness over all of humanity and the prophets may be a witness over you. This witness is iqamatul hujjah. The prophets have come so that you know the truth from the falsehood, so that the iqamatul hujjah is given. And we also learn as well that Allah has made a simple rule upon Himself. Allah has made a rule upon Himself. Allah Himself has a rule book that He follows. He has a guidelines that He has implemented upon Himself. As He says in the Quran, كَتَبَ رَبُّكُمْ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ. Your Lord has ordained for Himself. Allah has rules, but it is Allah who sets those rules. No one has the audacity or the power or the right to set rules for Allah other than Allah. So Allah has decreed rules for Himself, and Allah has done so in order to be the most merciful and the most compassionate and the most just. And of those rules that Allah has established, Surah Al-Isra, verse 15, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. We are not going to punish any nation until we send a prophet amongst them. We're not going to punish any nation until we send a prophet amongst them. In Surah An-Nisa, verse 165, لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرُّسُلِ. So that we don't want any person of mankind to have an excuse in front of Allah after the prophets have been sent. Meaning, if the prophets have not been sent, they might have an excuse. The fact that the prophets have been sent, now there is no excuse. In Surah Al-Qasas, verse 59, وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ مُهْلِكَ الْقُرَىٰ حَتَّى يَبْعَثَ فِي أُمِّهَا رَسُولًا يَتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِنَا. Your Lord shall never destroy a town until He sends to that town from its own people, from its people, that Rasulan is going to send a Rasul who is going to recite to them his verses. So Allah will never destroy a town until He sends a Rasul to them. And that Rasul, يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِنَا. Only after the revelation comes and the prophets come has the excuse been lifted up. And that is why in Jahannam itself, in Jahannam itself, the people of Jahannam will be asked by the angels, didn't messengers come? How could you end up over here? Surah Al-Fatir, verse 37. وَهُمْ يَصْطَرِخُونَ فِيهَا رَبَّنَا أَخْرِجْنَا نَعْمَلْ صَالِحًا غَيْرَ الَّذِي كُنَّا نَعْمَلْ. They're going to be begging the angels, and they're going to be begging Allah, oh Allah, get us out of here and allow us to get one more chance so that we can do what we did not used to do. Then Allah says, أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ مَا يَتَذَكَّرُ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرُ وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرُ. Two things we gave you. Didn't we give you enough time so that you could think rationally? And didn't we send prophets to you? It's not as if you were babies and then you passed away. They might have an excuse on the Day of Judgment. You had a life. You lived 40, 50, 60, 70 years. You had a full life. You chose to turn your life away from reality and to live in the bubble of your hedonism and pleasures. You didn't think about your purpose and your reality. And we sent you the messenger. وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرُ. The messenger was there. He brought the message for you. And you still chose to turn away. So then Allah says, do what you want. فَذُوقُوا فَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ نَصِيرٍ. You will continue to taste this punishment. And Surah Al-Mulk, verses 8 to 9. That تَكَادُ تَمَيَّزُ مِنَ الْغَيْدِ كُلَّمَا أُخْيَ فِيهَا فَوْجٌ. Every time a new batch is thrown into Jahannam, the guardians of Jahannam say, didn't a prophet come to you? How could you end up here? And they respond, بَلَى. Indeed, a prophet did come. قَدْ جَاءَنَا نَذِيرٌ. But we rejected that prophet. And we said, Allah has not sent anything to this prophet. Right? So to reject the messengers is to reject Allah. And to deny the messenger is to deny Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the prophets are sent. When they are rejected, then Jahannam is due upon the people. Surah Ghafir, verse 50. That the gatekeepers of Jahannam will reply that أَلَمْ يَأْتِكُمْ رُسُلٌ مِّنْكُمْ. Didn't the prophets come to you with clear proofs? قَالُوا بَلَى. They're going to say, yes, indeed they came. And so the gatekeepers will say, فَدْعُوا. Go ahead and make dua. وَمَا دُعَى كَافٍ إِلَّا فِي ضَلَالٍ. The prayer of the kafir will be in complete uselessness. Won't be of any value. So the point being that Allah Azza wa Jal has clearly mentioned in multiple verses that of the wisdom of sending the prophets is إِقَامَةُ الْحُجَّةِ. And this is because Allah created us different from the other creations. Allah created us different from the other creations. We have the capacity to think, and we have an innate desire to know the truth. And if Allah had not sent any prophet or any messenger, our capacity to think and our innate desire could lead us to some knowledge, but it couldn't lead us to perfect knowledge. And our innate knowledge and our intellects are not necessarily foolproof. Sometimes they're misguided. Sometimes they're mistaken. So by sending the prophets, we have checks and balances put into place. In other words, let me rephrase, and this is a very deep topic and it deserves much longer than this short, 5 minutes I'm going to be doing here. We can say that there are three primary sources of knowledge that are interplaying with one another. Okay, the first of them is the deepest and the most subconscious and the one that is embedded in us without even our knowledge. We don't even know we know, and yet we do. And that is the fitrah. That is the innate nature that Allah created mankind upon. فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا. This is the fitrah that Allah has embodied mankind or created mankind upon. And our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, every single child is born and he has that fitrah upon the fitrah. And then his parents come and corrupt him. Society comes and changes him. So the fitrah is pure, and the fitrah has an innate knowledge. What is the innate knowledge of the fitrah? The fitrah tells us many things, and of them is that there must be a higher being. There must be a God out there, and that we want to worship that God. We like connecting with that God. That's why religious people, generally speaking, live happier lives, because any type of religiosity, even if it is misguided, is better than no religiosity. And that's why religious people of other faith traditions, generally speaking, they have better lives and less, you know, issues facing them in terms of their own psychological issues than those outside of faith traditions. And the fitrah also teaches us the basics of morality, the basics of wanting to be good, and what is overall good: honesty, truthfulness, justice, kindness, compassion. That's embodied in the fitrah. And we despise evil and killing and bloodshed and hurting people. We don't do that. The fitrah tells us it's wrong to do. This is a subconscious embedded knowledge. And it is the knowledge that we don't even know we have, because it's so deep. And it is the knowledge that we are not taught, we are born with, right? So that's the fitra knowledge. Then you have the second knowledge, which is the knowledge of the brain, the knowledge of the aql. That is acquired knowledge. The fitra is not acquired. It is embedded. It is inherent. It is intrinsic. As for the knowledge of the aql, it is acquired. And we do so by our own observation and studying and the cumulative efforts of those before us. And so we will learn the sciences, mathematics, history. We will be able to go to the moon and come back. This is acquired knowledge. Our intellect Allah blessed us with. And the intellect and the fitrah, they overlap like two circles of the Venn diagram. Certain things of the fitrah, they are provable via the intellect, and certain things are known from the fitrah. And the intellect knows much that the fitrah does not know. But there is an overlap between the two. Now, the intellect is not divine, and the intellect can be wrong. How many times did mankind think they know certain thing and they don't know it? Even today, we might think we know something and we turn out to be false. The fitrah is not verifiable. Who's going to judge one's fitrah? We need a third source that is going to be divine and perfect. We need a third source that will be the checks and balances between the fitrah and between the aql. And that third source is the source of wahi. It is the source of the inspiration and revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, Allah azza wa jal basically says, your fitrah and your intellect, yes, they're good, and yes, they can take you so far, but as a mercy to you, I'm not going to punish you. If your fitrah messes up and gets corrupted, if your aql misguides you, I'm not going to punish you until what? Until the prophets come. And when the prophets come, they can line up and they can make sure that your fitrah is pure and your intellect is rightly guided. So the prophets come with the truth, pristine and clear. And because it is pure, the fitrah that is pure is rekindled. The pure fitrah recognizes the truth of the prophets and it is attracted to it. And the aql that is sincere, the intellect that is wanting the truth, when the truth is presented, the intellect finds it appealing, and the intellect will click in and will lock in perfectly with what the prophets come with. And this is why you need the prophets, because the prophets and the knowledge of the prophets is the ultimate checks and balances. And it allows the person the opportunity to compare and to contrast what they themselves have. I can give you a simple example in this regard, and that example is, suppose for example that before the time of glasses, you know, glasses are only been around for like 300 years or so, 200 years, suppose before the time of glasses, right, that you're living in a society, nobody has glasses, and a person is born with some defect of the eyes, can't really see 100%, maybe they have, you know, a power that's -3, -4, but that's what they know, society, that's what they've grown up with, right? That they're looking at the whole world and their eyes are not fully, you know, that's what they come to terms with. They would have no idea of how other people are seeing, because that's what they understand. Now, suppose, you know, optometrist comes along, right? And sees this young man or young woman, he'll go, you have a problem with your eyes, gives him a pair of glasses. Now he sees the world and he realizes, oh my God, I didn't know this. I wasn't able to see. Then he takes the glasses back and now the optometrist goes on. Now, this person who has the opportunity to see the world clearly, is he going to go back to how he was? Or is he going to say, hey, I need to hunt that optometrist down. I need to follow him or get the glasses or do whatever. This glass analogy, this is the knowledge of the prophets. And the person who cannot see properly, maybe a little bit, this is the knowledge of pre-prophethood. The prophets come with a knowledge that is solid and crystal clear. And anybody who has a pure heart, when they put the glasses on, they're going to see everything crystal clear and they will realize they didn't have good eyesight and this person's coming with good eyesight. Now, if they choose to hand those glasses, suppose he's giving them for free. Suppose he says, take. If they choose to give those glasses back, well then, they deserve to live in blindness, right? That's literally what Allah says in the Quran, that you're going to be blind. The prophets came to with light, the prophets came to with guidance, and you chose to turn away. The prophets came, يُخْرِجُهُم مِّنَ الظُّرُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ, taking them out of darkness into light. They're telling them the light, but they chose to turn their backs and walk back into the darkness. Just like somebody wears the glasses and then throws it back and says, I'm going to live in my lifestyle. Well then, so what? You have chosen, you will face the consequences of that. So this is the beautiful, explanation of these three things: the fitrah, the intellect, and the knowledge of the prophets. The fitrah and the intellect theoretically can be correct, but they can only take you so far. And if you want to see how far they can take you, look at the first 40 years of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life. That is the embodiment of the perfect fitrah. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the purest of pure fitras. No one can be more pure than he sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is the pure fitrah. Yet still, that fitrah was not able to get to the details of iman and the rituals and halal and haram. That's why Allah's revelation comes down, and Allah's revelation clarifies, elucidates, plus those whose fitrah is corrupted and those whose intellect is misguided, they can now see clearly, and then it is up to them. So in Allah's mercy, He will not punish until the prophets have come, and this is the point of iqamat al-hujjah. Once the evidence has been established, and that is by exposure to the message of the prophets, then in reality, the person who rejects that is just as arrogant as the one who was given glasses to see. He clearly sees and then he throws them off and wishes to live in blindness. That person deserves every punishment coming to him. And that is why this is iqamatul hujjah that is being given. The evidence of the truth of religion is being established via the message of the prophets of Allah. Inshallah, with this we come to the conclusion of today's lecture. Inshallah, we'll continue with our introductory series still about the reality of the prophets and the nature of a prophethood and prophecy. Until next time, Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب ما كان حديثا يفترى ولكن تصديق الذي بين يديه وتفصيل كل شيء وهدى ورحمة لقوم يؤمنون.